Did you find that anybody around you started treating you differently,
right.
Do you know what I mean? Because I find what you're saying is, to me, is similar to maybe a kid growing up that, especially around Halifax, say, that starts going to hang out with somebody else that nobody really knows or doesn't like because they don't know them. And so their friends start telling them, why are you hanging with? For me, it was, I saw it a lot because I grew up, half my life, I grew up down on Creighton Street. So I knew people and from basketball. And then half my life, I grew up in the South End. So I knew a lot of, different either black or white kids or rich or poor. So I always saw saw the same thing from both sides, where I'd see, you know, T-Bear going to hang out with kids in the South End and him telling me some of his friends didn't like that because they don't want him to go hang out with those kids. Whereas mm-hmm. I go and then the South End kids don't want to go hang out in the North End or go to parties in the North End because they're this prejudice that something might happen. Yeah. They're worried. You're getting the same reaction from both sides, right? And both sides usually are the ones blaming each other, where I'm like, for me, it's like everybody is very similar. It's just everybody's really uncomfortable and awkward to get past what you said. You got to put, you said word for word, I started talking to her. I realized I had to put myself forward. I had to focus on me and stop worrying about the other people and their thoughts, right? And because you're saying, well, everybody hated her. It could have been so easy for you to just be like, well, I'm going to follow the crowd and not like her too. But you didn't. And I find that holds a lot of kids back, especially in Halifax, especially in places that might be segregated or, you know what I mean? Where it's like one kid is trying to step outside their comfort box because they might see something in somebody else and they might go there. And then some of their friends are looking at them funny. Oh, you're different. Are you, mm-hmm. you're changing up on us.
Mm-hmm. It's funny because inside it's like that a lot, because what it comes down to is you have the two sides, basically the North End and the South End, but you have that inside with, you have the guys that want to get out and you have the guys that are okay with being there. They're not happy they're there. They're just complacent in their situation. So you have that with, like when I got talking to this PO and we ended up becoming, you know, developing a working relationship. Yeah, there were a lot of guys who were looking at me a little bit differently. But then my true friends were the ones that realized, okay, Chico's just trying to get out. And why would I want him to sit here with me when he has a family out there that's waiting for him? Like, yo, if we can push him up, let's try and get him out. And it comes a sense where you have to pick your friends wisely inside, because everybody doesn't know each other. So it's a community of 500 or 600 people coming from all across the country, being put into one environment, being told to live together, but nobody knows each other. And it's on you to pick out the people that you want to hang around with. So you have 600 people to choose from. And how do you choose a circle of 5, 6, 7 people that you're going to call your mm-hmm. immediate friends that you're going to have to live with, for some people for 2 years, some people are there for the rest of their life. So how do you choose that intimate circle that you want to be around? Right. And choosing that is more than half the battle, because you have the people that want to sell dope that are going to get you in trouble and get you shipped in just because you're friends with them. You have the guys who are big egos that are going to go get in a fight. And now because you're their friend, you must fight too, because that's just how prison works. You have to have somebody's back because they're going to have your back. And then now you're in a problem and you have to do things that you ultimately don't want to do, but you have to do for survival and to make sure that you live to see another day as well. Right. So choosing your friends wisely. And I remember choosing some friends and them having my best interest at heart when I sat down and told them. And this is how I realized that men can actually be men and have full grown man conversations. When we sat down and we used to sit back every night and talk, and we would cook and we'd have the game going on the big TV, and we'd be there chilling, we'd be playing our music. And, you know, we would do that. We would joke around all the time. But then something would happen to someone's life, or every year or 2 years you get these reports that they write on you, and we would have serious conversations as a group and try and get people's feedback on these reports. What do you think? How'd your report go? Who wrote yours? Mm-hmm. This is who wrote mine. Mm-hmm. And we would ultimately have these serious conversations. And when I got the group that I had, we would talk and guys would be like, yo, like, I want to get out. And you know, you have friends when you got guys that are like, I want you to get out, but they're not. They're being genuine, and they're like, yo, what can I do to help you get out? All right, look, bro, and this is real friendship. Like, I'm still smoking. I just copped a little bit of dope. I'm going to be selling it. Yo, don't come around me all the time. Like, let's see each other when we work out. We can eat together, but, yo, if you want to get out, just avoid me. And a real man, a real friend will do that, but then you'll have some friends in some circles where it's like they'll come around them, and they won't say – it's like – you getting in somebody's car and them not telling you that they have a gun in there. And you making the choice and you making the decision whether or not you want to get in the car. Let allow me to make the decision. If I still want to take that chance to drive with you from point A to point B, well, at least you let me know that that's in there instead of being put in a situation where now it's like, wow, come on, bro. Why couldn't you tell me that? So we had a lot of conversations, and I had a couple of other friends who were in the same mindset. There was about three of us that were in the same mindset of wanting to get out. And there were three or four of them that weren't at the point in their sentence where they had the opportunity to get out, but they were still thinking it. So we, they were like, look, I'm not all the way there yet. So I'm still walking the fence. I'm going to be getting in a little bit of shit. I'm not going to lie to you, but I'm still going to support you guys in trying to get out. And ultimately we were able to, the few of us that were in that mindset, able to, as a unit, always talk about, okay, this is what we're thinking, this is what my PO say, this is what your PO saying. And as a group, the three of us that were that got in that mind state, we got ourselves out of there, and we didn't do it alone. And we used to, we had a group, but the other people that were in the group as well played a role in it, because they were also supportive and didn't turn our backs on us. And that's a major thing, because you don't want to lose friends that you've developed relationship with for 7 years, 8 years, because you decide you want to get out. Ultimately, we have a saying in there, freedom is a must. If freedom is a must, support me that I'm at the point where I realize I want to get out. Like, you guys know that ultimately everybody wants to get to their family. If I can spend one less day in here with you and one more day with my family, isn't that what we ultimately want? That's what we preach. We preached that 8 years ago when we were just starting. Now I'm at the point where I can get out. Are we still preaching that exact same thing? If we are, let's show it. Let's be about it. And that's where we got to. That's how I know that those guys are actually friends, because it's easy to say it when it's like when something's 10 years away. It's easy to say, oh, bro, yeah, man, I hope you get out. I hope you get out. Well, now that time is here. That time is today. Do you still feel the same way? Are you going to try and sink me? Do you still want to keep me here? Are you going to sabotage me so I'm still here with you? Because that does that major happen? Oh, my God, that happened so much. When I was getting older, I never told anybody. I told two or three of my closest people. And I'm like, yo, don't tell anybody. When I was going, this is how I got out. Like, I went from medium to minimum, which is the hardest part. It's harder to get from medium to minimum than it is to get from minimum to the street. And I remember going, and I left on a Wednesday, and we played basketball every Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday there. It was sort of like night hoops. And I remember the guys saying to guys going and being like, go down to Unit 6 to grab Chico. And guys are like, Chico's not here anymore. They're like, what? Yeah, Chico's gone. Like, he left. What? He didn't say anything? Yo, I didn't want to get sore. And I wrote a couple letters afterwards like, yo, it's no disrespect to you. You're my friend, but you weren't in my immediate circle. Like, I felt comfortable telling you, but how do I know that at supper you're not going to be like, yo, you know, Chico's leaving on Wednesday. Then them have somebody that's against me. And like, no, man, it's no disrespect to you. It's just more respect to my family. It's better that I show them the ultimate respect rather than you, because they're the ones who are out here putting the time in, waiting for me, being supportive. So I gotta, you know, show them that I got their back too. And yeah, I can't tell you, I'm gone though. Hopefully you're happy for me.
Man, I feel like it's crazy though, because I feel like that's actually similar again to like what you're saying is like, it's for me, kids growing up, and I feel like it relates more to people that start at a lower level on the food chain in parentis or whatever. But you got to pick, like you say, you got to pick your friends wisely. Your friends have to have the best interest for you.
Yeah.
Which like you said, it's hard, right? It's really difficult to figure out. It's like you said, people can always say something so easily, right? And I say that because I find a lot of, for me, I see so many talented kids or youth around Halifax that grow up with people and they develop friendships. But once they start reaching ages where they start maybe trying things new that their group of friends don't want to try, they might, like you're saying, they might, you know, what are you going to do if you get, what are you going to do? Like, you start hanging with people that are going to be getting in fights all the time, but you're trying to go play basketball in university and get a university degree. Are you going to keep hanging out with the same guys that keep getting in fights, or, you know what I mean, have a beef with somebody across town or something like that? Like, those are big decisions for a kid to make. And you know what I mean? It's not easy. So I think hearing it from you saying, like, listen, you know what I mean? Like, these are things that I had to do, you know. I had to send a letter I had to send a letter afterwards telling the person, listen, I like you a lot, but like, I just had to make sure things were, you know what I mean? I think
100%.
I think kids struggle a lot, and hearing you say that, like, I think kids, if kids are listening to this, you got to listen. You got to put yourself and what you want to do first. You can't worry everything about, you know, if your friends are going down a different path. If they're your true friends, they'll understand you and support you no matter what. If they start getting at you because you're doing things that make them uncomfortable, that then it starts being like kind of a question mark. It's like, okay, bro, like, are you like, do you want to see me do well, or what do you want? You want me to just be by your side no matter what? Like, if you go down a bad path, you're just gonna drag me with you.
Exactly, because I struggled with that too. And it's crazy because when I was inside, the biggest thing that they always told me, they're like, Chico, if it was up to me right now, I'd let you out. And this is well before my dates and stuff, right? So I'd be like, well, why? They're like, well, and all my reports are like, we know you're smart enough. We know you're capable enough. We know you can do it. But there's just the other little intangibles that we're not too sure of. And I'm like, what do you mean? They're like, Chico, your loyalty. Like, you always speak of being loyal to your friends. And I'm like, yeah, I'm loyal to my soil. I'm loyal to my friends. And they're like, yes, but can I help you with your loyalty? And I'm like, what do you mean? They're like, take this in and one day you'll realize it. Actually, that lady that I was talking to you about, first of all, she said to me, Chico, one day you'll wake up and you'll realize you don't want to be here anymore. And I'm like, I don't really understand what that means because I still have to be here for another minimum of 8 years. Yeah. But okay. So she said that to me one day and I was like, whatever, you know what I mean? And then she also said this to me. She's like, Chico, take this in. You can still be loyal, but there's different types of loyalty. So she's like, you can still have your friends in life and never not be a loyal person, but there's difference with being loyal and going to grab a knife and a gun and do something to somebody because somebody said something to one of your friends. That's loyalty, what you would think growing up as a teenager. Yeah. Yeah. And that's what you guys define as loyalty. But Chico, there's different types of loyalty. You can be loyal to your friend by, if he needs $50 for gas money, giving it to him. If he needs help on a Saturday moving his house, he just bought a new house, he needs help moving and he doesn't want to pay movers, but you volunteer to go help him move. If he needs, in a pinch, you to watch his son or daughter because something just happened and you say, okay, yo, bro, come drop your kid off. If he needs, his wife needs you to go pick her up from work because he's stuck in traffic, or there's different types of ways. She said, Chico, there's so many ways that you can be loyal to your friends that they should understand that you're being loyal. It doesn't necessarily, violence doesn't define loyalty. You know what I mean? There's more ways that define loyalty. And, you know, I took that in a lot too. Like, that was that stuck with me. Like, I thought about that a lot. And I was just like, you know what? The more and more I think like that, it's like, okay, you want me to, if something happens in here, you want me to defend you and help you out, where, okay, today we won. Today we won the war. We stabbed the guy. We did something. We feel good today. But that's just the immediate gratification. In 5 days, right, and 7 days, do you think people are going to remember that we did that? Do you think people are still going to be talking about that? We're today's news. In 5 or 7 days, when we're getting shipped to a different place, and now we are 3 years away from being back to the point where we were when we were 8 years away from seeing our family. Mm-hmm. So now, instead of being 8 years away, now we're 11 to 12 years away. Now we just add it for no reason because we had our egos in the way and we wanted to be loyal to each other. We just add it and we just took 1,000 days away from seeing our family. Why? Because we wanted to step up and do something that's like, yo, if you don't want to put yourself first, which you should, put your family first. They're the ones who take your calls. They're the ones who got you. They're the ones who send you your cards on your birthday, or all your friends. You might have two or three, and those are your friends that send you your cards on your birthday, that send you a Christmas card, that write you a letter. But then you want me to come here and ultimately be so super loyal to you and forget that my family got me. It's like, no. Right. And once I got to that point, once I got to that point and realized, like, yo, family over everything, or my family's got me, it's like, that's when the switch goes off. And it's like, all right, like, we can do this.
Thanks for tuning in to TOTFC Podcast. If you liked it and you want to hear more, please share it with a friend, a family member, a teammate, or anybody. Like the video, consider subscribing to TOTFC Podcast.